Or can we join together this morning to worship the Lord by singing our opening hymn, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. We'll stand as we sing together, please.
See you.
Can we bow, please, just for a few moments, still our hearts before the Lord now. Our loving Father, we do thank you for, again, this opportunity of coming to honor, Father, the great name of our God in worship and in praise this morning. We thank you, dear Father, for the privilege that is ours. Lord, we thank you for the one who is, Father, the great creator that became our Savior. And thank you, Father, for the love that has been revealed in, Father, the cross of Calvary. We thank you that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. We thank you for the victory that has been won for us through the glorious resurrection. We thank you, dear Father, for the hope. Father, the promises of God, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. And Lord, we thank you, dear Father, we can stand with confidence this morning, knowing that the Lord is my helper. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you are the shield and buckler. And Father, you're nigh unto them that put their trust in thee. We thank you that the Lord is my light and my salvation. And whom shall I fear? And the Lord is the strength of my life, and whom shall I be afraid? We thank you, dear Father, for the wonder of your salvation. We thank you for your grace. We thank you, dear Father, even over the week that has passed. We have known your help, your encouragement, and your blessing. And our Father, we thank you, Lord, for the hope that lies before us, that one day we will see the King in his glory. My Father, we see things through a glass darkly, but then face to face. And Lord, we thank you, dear Father, for the hymn writer who penned those words, face to face with Christ my Savior, face to face, oh, what will it be when with rapture I behold him? Father, we thank you, Lord, for that hope that burns within our hearts today. We thank you, dear Father, for the wonder of your grace. Father, salvation, the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. We bless thee, dear Father. We bow before you. We exalt your holy and your precious name. And we pray that you'll help us to worship you this morning. Father, with hearts that have been strangely warmed. Father, as we think of the goodness of God, Father, bless, we pray, everyone who has honored you by their presence here this morning. Those who have, Father, come with a desire to be in the house of God and to worship the one who loved them and gave himself for them. Bless each one. Remember those who would love to be with us but are unable this morning. We commit them to you, Lord. We ask in Jesus' name that you will minister to them whatever their needs are today. We ask, Lord, that soon they will be found again amongst your people in the presence of God and knowing the blessing of God. Keep your hand upon each one, we pray. For those, dear Father, who, Lord, need your healing touch, we thank you, dear Father, that you're the same yesterday, today, and forever. We thank you that there is a balm in Gilead. There is a physician there. We thank you, Lord, for one who is able to heal and to save and to satisfy. And so, loving Father, we pray that you will bless. We pray for everywhere where the word of God is going forth today. We ask, Lord, that you'll bless and that you'll undertake and that you will minister and bless. Father, encourage those who are laboring for thee and all of our churches this morning and all of the churches in, Father, this community. We ask, Lord, that where the word of God is faithfully preached, that you will bless the preaching of the word of God. We know that faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. So, Lord, minister and meet need today, we pray. Think of those in the mission field, Lord, serving you. We thank you, Lord, for those who have shared with us in recent days, Lord, of the Father, the work that they have been involved in. We thank you for the meeting on Thursday and for Frank. And we ask, Lord, that you'll bless him as he returns to the work that you've called him to. We pray for Stephen and Linda and that you will bless and encourage them, we pray. Others, dear Father, who are laboring, we pray for the Brookses this morning. We ask, Lord, that you'll be. And Father, we pray for Lord, and for Puts his Lord commit to you. We thank you for those who have come and shared with us, Father, of the work that they have been involved in. And we ask, Lord, that you'll greatly encourage. Bless Derek, we pray, even as he serves you. We pray, Father, that he might be conscious of your help and your blessing. Pray for Gary and Allison and Carol here. We pray, dear Father, that in the ongoing work, they might be very, very conscious of the blessing of God. Father, that you will go before them, meet need, and Father, undertake and encourage and bless, we pray. So, Lord, we commit ourselves to you this morning. We thank you, dear Father, for the joy of being in your presence. And we ask, Lord, that you will just minister to us today, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing another hymn just now. In tenderness he sought me, weary and sick with sin, and on his shoulders brought me back to the fold, his fold again. While the angels in his presence sang, courts, until the courts of heaven sought me, God that bought me, oh, the grace that brought me to the fold. Certainly a theme worth singing, and singing from the depth of our hearts this morning. Standing to sing if we can.
Thank you.
beautiful hymn. It'd be nice just to say, right, we'll leave it open for you to share how God brought you by grace to the fold, but maybe we haven't time this morning to do that. But I trust that as you recall his mercy, that your heart is rejoicing this morning in all that he has done for you. We want to welcome you in the Savior's precious name. I trust that the Lord will bless as we meet together. COVID, an awareness of the presence of God, and he has given us his promise that if we two or three meet together in his name, there he is in the midst, and we're looking to the Lord for his blessing this morning. Do please remember this evening, pre-service prayer meeting at 6, and then the evening service at 6:30, and God willing, solid ground will be here to minister in song, and I will be bringing God's word. That's 6. Listen for those who remember. On Monday, there's a board meeting for board members. Please just remember 7:30 for the board members on Monday. Tuesday will be our missionary prayer meeting, and David Burke will be here, God willing, of the work that he's been involved in. That's on Tuesday at 8 p.m. Then on Friday, Lifeliners, again for the boys and girls. 6:30 for the boys and girls in Lifeliners. Then Saturday will be the ladies' meeting. Encourage all of the ladies to come. Lynn Wilson will be the speaker, and that Saturday at 10:30. And if you can encourage other ladies to come with you, please do that. And we know the Lord wants for that. Then in the will of the Lord, on next Lord's Day, there will be Sunday school, 10:15, and then 10:30 for teen search. The morning service at 11:30, and then the evening service at 6:30. God willing, again, I will be here to minister God's word. Then just to mention the special seminars in Gannon. That's on the 5th of February for the first one, when John Matthews will be lecturing from the Old Testament Minor. So that's on the 5th of February. All the details. There's some leaflets still there, and again, we encourage you, if you're planning to go, at least speak to Mr. Park, let him know, so that there'll be enough handouts and provisions made for those who are attending. So that's the first of the seminars on the 5th, and then the second on the 9th of February. I think that's all, and by way of announcement, we're waiting you for your gifts and offerings for the Lord's work. Bow again, please, for a moment in prayer. Our loving Father, again, we thank you for your provision for us. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity of supporting, Father, the work of God around the world, and Father, across the street, and wherever it is, Lord, that there are those who are reaching out. We ask, Lord, that you will just take these offerings, and Lord, use them for the extension of thy kingdom, for the glory of your great name. We thank you, Lord, that You have given and given and given again. And Lord, we want to lift our hearts with grateful thanks. Pray that you'll bless now each one who has given, for we are in Jesus' name. Do as a church, congratulations to Jane and Maxwell on the birth of their son on Friday. I just trust that the Lord's blessing will be upon the family, and we will remember them in prayer. To the word by whose hand my people stand, if we can, please, to sing. This morning I'd like to turn to Exodus and chapter 1. Exodus and chapter 1. First chapter of the book of Exodus. And these are the names of the children of Israel, which came into Egypt. Every man and his household came with Jacob: Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, Zebulun, and Benjamin, Dan, Naphtali, Gad, and Asher. And all the souls that came out of the loins of Jacob were 70 souls, for Joseph was in Egypt already. And Joseph died, and all his brethren, and all that generation. And the children of Israel were fruitful and increased abundantly, and multiplied and waxed exceeding mighty, and the land was filled with them. Now there arose up a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph. And he said unto his people, Behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come on, let us deal wisely with them, lest they multiply and it come to pass that when there falleth out any war, they join also unto our enemies and fight against us and get them out of the land. Therefore, they did set over them taskmasters to afflict them with their burdens. And they built for Pharaoh treasures of pennies and Ramesses. But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew. And they were grieved because of the children of Israel. And the Egyptians made the children of Israel serve with rigor. And they made their lives bitter with hard bondage, in mortar and in brick, and in all manner of service in the field. All their service within they made them to serve was with rigor. And the king of Egypt spake unto the Hebrew midwives, of which the name of the one was Sephar, and the name of the other Puer. And he said, When you do the office of a midwife for the Hebrew women, and see them upon the stool, if it be a son, then thou shalt kill him. But if it be a daughter, then she shall live. But the midwives feared God, and did not as the king of Egypt commanded them, but saved the men children alive. And the king of Egypt called for the midwives and said unto them, Why have ye done this thing? And they saved the men children alive. And the midwives said unto Pharaoh, Because the Hebrew women are not as the Egyptian women, for they are lively and undelivered ere the midwife come into them. Therefore God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and waxed very mighty. And it came to pass, because the midwives feared God, that he made them houses. And Pharaoh charged all his people, saying, Every son that is born ye shall cast into the river, and every daughter ye shall save alive. And we'll end there, knowing that the Lord will bless the reading of his word. And we bow, please, for a moment in the Lord's presence. Our loving Father, we do thank you for, again, this privilege of opening the precious word of God. We thank you, dear Father, that you've said in your word that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God shall man live. And so, loving Father, we pray that you will, Father, feed us. Lord, that you will minister to us through your word. We ask, Lord, that your blessing will be upon the word of God this morning. Father, that you will speak to us. That, Father, you will reveal yourself to us. We thank you, dear Father, that thou art God, and besides thee there is no other. We just lift our hearts in grateful thanks to thee. And so, loving Father, to this end I ask for the help of the Spirit of God. In my weakness, Lord, I pray that you will be my wisdom and my strength and help. And Lord, I pray that your name will be glorified. And Lord, that Christ might be exalted, even, Father, this morning, for we ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. 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 You might consider it very morbid, but have you ever thought what you want on your headstone? The epitaph at the end of your life, well, maybe we mightn't have much say in that, but maybe if someone else was to sum up your life whenever your little day here on earth is over, I wonder what they would say about me or you as we live our life down here and people observe and watch our lives. Moses perhaps was one of the greatest men that ever lived, and yet we cannot find a place of burial for Moses. Maybe God, and knowing that people would have maybe made a shrine out of the place where Moses was buried, but he was buried in a secret by God alone. And it was God who bore testimony to the life of Moses. And you'll find recorded for us in Deuteronomy chapter 34, it says, "And Moses went up into the plain of Moab and the mount of Nebo and the top of Pisgah and over against Jericho. And the Lord showed him all in the land of Gilead and Dan and all of Naphtali and the land of Ephraim and Manasseh and all the land of Judah. Unto the uttermost sea, and the south of the plain of the valley of Jericho, and the cities of the plains of Zoar. And the Lord said unto him, This is the land which I swear unto Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, saying, I will give it unto thy seed. I have caused thee to see it with thine eyes, but thou shalt not go over thither. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died in the land of Moab, according to the word of the Lord. And he buried him in the valley in the land of Moab, over against Beth-Hor. But no man knoweth of his sepulchre unto this day. And Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eyes were not dim, nor his natural forces abated." We recognize that as God buried Moses. We find in Numbers in chapter 12, God's testimony of Moses. He said, "My servant Moses." He was speaking to Miriam and to Aaron, who were opposing Moses. And he was comparing Moses to others. And he said, "My servant is not so, who is faithful in all his house. And with him will I speak mouth to mouth, even appearing not in the dark speeches or in the similitudes of the Lord shall he behold." And so the testimony that God gave of Moses was, "He is my servant and he is faithful in all his house." You find in the New Testament, the writer of the Hebrews again, refers to Moses, "Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Jesus Christ, who is faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house." What a tremendous testimony. And that the writer of the Hebrews could say that as the Lord Jesus was faithful, so Moses was faithful in all his house, who was faithful unto him that appointed him. We find, as we read through the scripture, there are many, many references to the life of Moses. Moses is mentioned in 784 verses in the scripture. 848 times Moses' name is mentioned in the New and the Old Testament. He's described as the servant of God, the servant of God. And so in the book of Exodus, we have here the record of the life of Moses. The Exodus speak about coming out and departing. And we know that a big part of the Old Testament history, and so often God refers back to the important event of bringing the children of Israel out of Egypt, out of bondage, and the great Exodus, where God brought the children of Israel out of bondage and into the land that he had promised. And it foreshadows all that God wants to do in the lives of men and women. God wants to bring every man and woman. God wants to bring us all. And I trust that this morning we've all experienced an exodus in our lives where God has come and delivered us from the bondage of sin. And God has brought us out from the bondage of sin into the liberty that is in Christ Jesus and into all the promises that God has for us. We have the Exodus in the Old Testament. We have the Exodus when on the day of Pentecost, God brought people out of their sin into an experience of being brought into the fellowship of God. And I trust that each one of us experienced that. But there's going to be another Exodus whenever God comes and he brings his people out of this dark world of sin and brings us into glory. And we enter into that place that God has prepared for us. And so we find that in the book of Exodus, there is so foreshadowing, and there are many lessons that we can learn. We look at the life of Moses, and there is mystery and grace, the grace of God, the wonder of God's dealings through Moses. We focus on the characters, but we want to think about the God who was the God of Moses. And the God who revealed himself, he says, my servant Moses, who was faithful in all mine house. And so we find that in the darkest of circumstances, God stepped in and raised up Moses to be his servant. We recognize that we have all of his failures. Whenever you look at his life, it is far from perfect. There were times that Moses made mistakes. He took things into his own hands. And as a result of that, he had to flee. We recognize that with his frustration with the children of Israel, he got angry and he smote the rock. And because of that, God was displeased with Moses. Yet we find God took this ordinary man, and God, through his amazing grace, revealed himself through Moses, and he faced an impossible situation. And it encourages us this morning as we come to the house of God that God still calls ordinary people. God takes ordinary people. We're reminded in James about Elijah. Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are. And yet God was able to use Elijah, and God was able to use Moses, and God was able to minister to him. An ordinary man is an instrument in the hand of God to impact millions and impact nations. Now we recognize when God came to Moses, or to Abraham, God made an amazing promise to Abraham that if God were to make that promise to you or me, perhaps our faith would stagger, because God had said that through Abraham's seed, all the families of the earth would be blessed. Defend, if God were to say to you and I that through our lives he was going to make us a blessing to people in this world, we recognize that we find this ordinary man God comes to and God reveals himself. The sovereign purposes of God are placed into the hand of a man of like passions as we are. And so we find here that we have Moses. We want to look at Moses perhaps as we want to learn some lessons from the life of Moses. The scripture tells us in Numbers chapter 12 again, it says, now the man Moses was very meek above all men that were upon the face of the earth. Moses was a man who was very meek, the scripture says. Now, if you take that word that is translated very meek and you compare it to other places in Scripture, you'll find that in Psalm 10, for example, arise, O Lord my God, and lift up thine hand, forget not the humble. So the word is translated there, the humble, when it speaks of Moses as one who was very meek. Again, the Lord has heard the desire of the humble, in verse 17. Again, he talks about the meek. Will he guide in judgment, and the meek will he teach his way? God is able to come to people who are humble, people who are meek, as the scripture tells us. Again, Psalm 34 and verse 2, my soul doth make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Psalm 37, but the meek shall inherit the earth, and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. So you find that the word, they're very meek, also speaks of one who is humble, very humble. Do you find if we are willing to bow before God, recognize that in ourselves we are nothing, and be humble before God, there is no limit to what God can do in our lives and through our lives for the glory of God. Moses, we learn many lessons. We see something of God's provision and protection in a dangerous world. And we recognize that whenever Moses was born, he was born into a world where there was great danger. Moses was one who experienced, and we see something of God's provision and God's protection. And we recognize that we have the same God. Elijah's God is our God. Moses' God is the God who can help us and protect us. Whatever dangers, whatever circumstances, whatever difficulties we find ourselves in, we find also that God not only provided protected, but we find Moses finding his identity in a troubled world. He was born into a Hebrew home, and yet he was adopted, as it were, into Pharaoh's household. And through all of the circumstances, Moses had to discover who he really is. And God wants us to experience or discover who we really are. In a sense, to recognize the purposes of God in our lives. We recognize that God brought Moses to a place where he chose the right path in a materialistic world. And dear friend, there are lessons. We're living in a materialistic world, and we will have choices to make, decisions to make in life. But we learn from the life of Moses that he was willing to reject, as it were, the pleasures of sin for a season, that he might experience the blessing of God, and he made wise choices. As we look at the life of Moses, we can learn our identity in Christ. We can learn the wisdom of making wise choices in the materialistic world. We find that Moses faced rejection and failure in a confusing world, and we recognize that for a period of his life, no doubt haunted by the rejection of his own people, who made you a judge and a ruler over us? And sometimes we find ourselves facing rejection. We find ourselves facing failures in our lives. Instead of seeing his people delivered by attacking the Egyptian who was smiting a Hebrew, he found that he had to run away for fear in his life. And he faced rejection and failure. And sometimes we have to deal with those kind of things. But God can make us. And God can mold us. God can reveal himself to us in the circumstances of life. We find that God isolated Moses, learning to care in a lonely world for 40 years. He spent in the backside of the desert. And yet it wasn't wasted time. And sometimes we find ourselves in circumstances and we feel that somehow we're isolated. Somehow we're in a place where things are difficult. And we wonder what is happening in our lives. And yet God can take those situations and circumstances in life, and God can use them. I remember when Patrick McGilligott was over and ministering, he had taken meetings here and he'd taken meetings in many of our churches. But I remember his testimony and how God amazingly came to Patrick McGilligott whenever he was brought up without the gospel and living all of the things that he was involved in. He was fascinated with football. He spent many hours playing football, coaching football. He spent many hours playing table tennis until he had, was able to perfect his skills in table tennis. He lived in the army and he learned all the disciplines in the army and many things. And then God broke into his life. And God amazingly dealt with him and saved him. And immediately God used him as he met with God, and God took him into the service of God. And when he went to Japan to serve God, he found it difficult. He invited people to come to his meetings and nobody would come. He was struggling. And then one day he went to get his hair cut. And whenever he went, it was very expensive to get your hair cut in Japan. And he thought, well, you know, my wife could do it. But he decided to go to meet the community and meet the people. And as he was sitting, the barber was talking to him about baseball and all of these things. And he says, oh, I don't know much about baseball. He says, well, our sport is football. And he says, oh, I used to coach. Oh, you coach? You coach football? Would you coach our young people? And he thought, no, Saturday is the day that I prepare. And he began to think about it and prepare about it. He was spending all day Saturday preparing for a meeting where only his own family and maybe one other person came. And he decided, he felt that God was leading him, and he decided that he would give his time to coaching these young people. And through that, 100 or maybe more than 100 young people were coming, and he had contact with their families, and God opened doors through something that he thought was just a waste of his time. He spent time playing table tennis, and the Japanese were fascinated with table tennis, and he used to challenge them. But they didn't know that he was an expert. He was brilliant and he could beat them. And God opened doors. And as you listen to his testimony, every situation he was in life, God took that later to use it for his glory in the service of God. And God brought Moses through lonely times, times of heartbreak, no doubt, of rejection, times when he had to find out who he really was and where he belonged and where his loyalties were. And he discovered the protection of God for him. And he was taught in all the wisdom. And he listened to the call of God in a busy world where God met with him and God called him. And so we find God's unfolding plans in a lost world. And so we find here in this chapter of Exodus that we've read together, now these are the names of the children of Israel that came out of into Egypt. And we see the word now connects us with all that has gone before. The word of the book of Genesis reveals how God had made a perfect world. And man's rejection of God's way ended in rebellion and rejection of the goodness of God. We see death and separation, confusion and judgment, and the call of God, that God called out of a world of confusion and a world of rejection. God called one man and gave him promises, God's covenant promises to Abraham. And so we find in Genesis chapter 12 that God revealed in the book of Genesis, now the Lord said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house into a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And dear friend, the call of God is always the same. God calls us into blessing. God calls us. He wants to make something of our lives. Broken lives are why he died on Calvary. And dear friend, Christ calls us. And he says, I will make you. And make. Very often we can make a mess of our lives. Very often we can have our own plans and they can fail. But if we're willing to hear the call of God and surrender our lives to the call of God, he is able to make us. He's able to make us. He says, I will bless thee. Dear friend, this morning God wants to bless. Dear friend, we need to be open to the blessing of God. We need to be open and sensitive to the call of God. And we find that God came and he says, I will bless thee and make thee a blessing. Dear friend, that's the calling of God upon every single life here this morning. God wants you to follow him. He will make you, and he will make you a blessing to a dark and difficult world. And so we find the great promise in chapter 15 of Genesis. And he brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward the heavens and tell the stars if thou were able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. And we have the great plan of God. And so we find in the unfolding of the book of Genesis, you come to chapter 60, chapter 46 and verse 3, where now Jacob, and you know the story so well, how Jacob had been deceived by his family. He thought that Joseph was dead, but now he hears that God has been preserving and protecting and fulfilling his promises. And Jacob and Joseph is now the governor in the land. And he said unto him, God said unto Jacob, I am the God of thy father. Fear not to go down to Egypt, for I will there make of thee a great nation. And I will go down with thee into the land. Notice the promise that God gave was that he told Abraham, I will make a great nation. But he told Jacob, I will make a great nation of you there. In the place of difficulty. In the place where they were going. Very often in scripture when you talk about going down to Egypt, it was a backward step. But this was a place where God was going to bless. Very often we try to run away from the place where God wants us to be. But dear friend, that's the important place to be. Whenever Elijah was standing before Ahab, he went and he hid himself. And God had given him a promise. Go to the brook Cherith and I will sustain thee there. And God said to Jacob, go down into Egypt and I will bless thee there. I wonder, dear friend, this morning, in all of our lives, are we there? Are we there? Are we there at the place of God's appointment? Are we where God wants us to be? The place where God wants to and will be able to bless us? And so we find that it tells us now these are the names of the children of Israel. The focus now is upon the nation, the children of Israel. And it tells us there at verse 5, all the souls that came out of the loins of Jacob were 70 souls. And Joseph was already, or in Egypt already. You see, dear friend, here are the names of the people. So often you find that names are important in Scripture because people are important. We sometimes talk about the health service or some other part of the government, say, you're only a number. But dear friend, you don't find people, in a sense, just as a number in Scripture, because every single person is important. Every person is valuable. And dear friend, you're valuable this morning, whatever your circumstances, whatever your situation in life. God knows our name. The Scripture tells us that when we trust him, he puts our names in the palms of our hand, that we're precious to him. And so there were 70 souls. And just 70 souls. It wasn't a great nation. But God had promised that he would bless them there. He would multiply them there. And then it tells us in verse 6, and Joseph died. And all his brethren and all that generation, Joseph died, and all his brethren, and all that generation. We recognize that here was a whole generation that had received the promises of God, had been directed by God, had been brought to the place. And the Scripture tells us that they had all died. And the children of Israel, in verse 7, it says, the children of Israel were fruitful and increased abundantly and multiplied and waxed exceedingly mighty, and the land was filled with them. We find that whenever Stephen was writing or speaking in the Acts of the Apostles, he says that in that amazing chapter 7 of the book of Acts, where Stephen is recounting all of the history of the nation of Israel, and he gave unto none inheritance, no, not so much as to set his foot upon. Yet he promised that he would give him for a possession and to his seed after him, when he had yet no children. And God spake in this wise, that his seed should sojourn in a strange land, and that they should bring for them into bondage and treat them evil 400 years. And the nation to whom they shall be brought into shall be in bondage. Shall it tells us in Exodus here that in chapter 12 it says that they sojourned, the children of Israel who dwelt in Egypt for 430 years. There was 400 years of hard bondage. There was 30 years perhaps whenever they remembered Joseph. But it says that, it tells us in Exodus chapter 12, and it came to pass at the end of 430 years, even in the self same day, it came to pass that all the hosts of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. God fulfills his promise. The very day that God had promised, God fulfilled his promise. And the children of Israel were fruitful and increased. It's an amazing thing. You think of that 400-year period. They went from 70 souls to maybe 2 or 2.5 or 3 million people. God increased them. God made them a mighty nation. God prospered them. God was with them. Even in all of the hardness and all of the difficulties that they faced, all of the difficulties did not hinder the promises of God. God was with them. God blessed them. God strengthened them. And whenever Moses led the children of Israel, there could have been as many as 3 million that came out of the land of Egypt. And so it tells us here in these verses that we've read this morning, now there arose a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph. And he said unto the people, his people, behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. An amazing thing. God had prospered them. And says, come on, let us deal wisely with them, lest they multiply and it come to pass that when they falleth out of any war, that they join themselves. And so we find, it tells us that, and again going back to Acts, where Stephen was speaking, but when the time of the promise drew near, which God had sworn to Abraham, the people grew and multiplied in Egypt until another king arose that knew not Joseph. That little word, another king, means another of a different type. And dear friend, there's lessons for us to learn here. It only took, in a sense, one generation for the blessing that Joseph had been to be forgotten. Only one generation to lose that godly influence. That's the tragedy. Sometimes we look back in the past. We thank God for the past. But here is another king. And he had forgotten that Joseph had been the one who had brought deliverance for them in a time of famine. Through Joseph, the whole land of Egypt was spared in the fierce famine that was for 7 years. And he forgot. And dear friend, the tragedy is that maybe even in one generation, people can forget. They can forget the blessings of God, the heritage that they've had. They forget the sacrifice that was made. There's a new generation, even in our own fellowship. We're talking about 50 years. Maybe only 40 years in Egypt. And they forgot. A new king that didn't know the blessing. And there's a generation perhaps growing up today that don't know the sacrifice that was made in the days of early times of blessing. When things were hard and difficult and when there was opposition. Were the people who were in churches perhaps that weren't preaching the gospel and they wanted their families to be raised in a place where the word of God would be preached? And when they left perhaps the denominations that their fathers had been in and they stepped out, there was persecution. there was difficulty. But there's a generation now that has forgotten. They sat under the privileges and the blessings, but they don't think of the costs and all that was involved. And so they forgot, and they knew not the blessings of the past. And so we find here that there was a new king. And that's the challenge in every generation. There are those who in generations past, faced the darkness of false religion. Men like Luther that stood against error and recognized that they had to take a stand. Here I stand. I can do no other. And they come out and God moved and God blessed. But there are those who are throwing away the truths of the grace of God. They're letting go. They're forgetting the blessings of the past. And there's a warning here in this passage of Scripture. We find that what we read in our Bible is up to date. It's not something that happened thousands of years ago, but it's a danger that we're facing today. That where God had blessed in the past, in a land that had known the blessing of God, there comes rulers, there comes people who rise up, people whose voices are heard, and they don't know the things that are precious, the things that were once valued, things that were honored, how God blessed in this land. And so we find that there was this time when there was a new king that knew not Joseph, and there was oppression, and there was affliction, and the government brought in new legislation. Come now, let us deal wisely. And so we find that they talked to the midwives, and they said, whenever a male child is born, put it to death. And so in a sense, we have this beginning of a satanic attack against the people of God. Are we living in a time when there's a satanic attack against the truth of God and the people of God? We recognize that God's promise in Genesis was that the seed of the woman would crush the serpent's head. And the serpent always has risen against to try to destroy the seed of the woman. God had promised that through Isaac, all the families of the earth, and Abraham, and through that male family, that there would come a savior and a deliverer. And if they could wipe out the males, then they could hinder the promises of God. And it was a satanic attack. And so it says that they set over them taskmasters and afflicted them. And they made them labor. And it says that afflicted them. The more that they afflicted them, the more they grew. And then we find that it tells us about how they made the children of Israel serve with vigor. See, dear friend, behind all of this was the sovereign hand of God. There was a danger for the children of Israel. They had grown up and they'd got accustomed to the lifestyle that they had lived. They had lived in bondage all their life. They had been downtrodden all of their days. Other generations had experienced God's freedom and blessing. But this generation was growing up and they were oppressed. And they knew nothing else. And they got accustomed to being oppressed. And the Scripture tells us that when they were there, they not only got comfortable in the land of Egypt, but it tells us in the Scripture that they began to worship the gods of Egypt. And whenever people settle down and whenever they begin to turn away from God, God begins to stir their nest. And God begins to move, make life uncomfortable in a sense in their sin and in their rebellion and in their... God had a greater plan. And so it tells us here how he spoke to the midwives and he introduced a bill of abortion bill to destroy. And we have these two midwives perhaps who were over all of the midwives in the land. One, Sapphira, the name means beautiful. The other name means splendor. And yet we have another attack against the promises of God and the purposes of God. And we need to realize that we're living in that kind of world where the enemy is seeking to introduce bills that will destroy the truth of the Word of God, where the enemy is opposing. And so the Bible tells us these midwives, they feared God. And God blessed and God protected them. And dear friend, the fear of the God is beginning of wisdom. And so it tells us here that they introduced this second law to wipe out all of the male population. Every son that is born shall be cast into the river. Now, the Egyptians, you remember when the plagues came, all of the plagues were against the gods of Egypt. So whenever they turned the water into blood, it was against the gods of the river Nile, the river gods and the sun gods and all of the other gods that they worshipped. And here they were taking the male children and sacrificing them to the river. We know that that's very often the way the enemy does, wants to sacrifice to their gods. We're those who are sacrificing to the god of pleasure. Oh, they want to have their pleasure. But if there's a pregnancy, they want to get rid of the pregnancy so they can enjoy their pleasures. And we recognize that here they were casting the children into the crocodiles. So we find in this passage of Scripture, this dark world. And we could ask the situation, well, how is God's promises going to be fulfilled? How is God going to fulfill his word whenever things are so much against the children of God? And yet we know the end of the story. That God, in that dark situation, God was making provision and God found a family. And from that family, God found a little boy. And God preserved. And I trust that God will help us as we look at the word of God. We recognize that we live in a world where there is difficulties, there's disappointments, there's challenges, but our eyes are unto the Lord, and he is the one who is able to deliver. He is the one who can guide us. He's the one who can direct us. And I trust that God will encourage us as we look at the story from the Word of God. We're going to sing a closing hymn this morning. A wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, and rivers of pleasure I see. We'll stand to sing.
Thank you.
Our loving Father, we do thank you for the God of Israel. We thank you, dear Father, that as you covered little Moses, that precious little life, covered him, dear Lord, with